Welcome back to another episode of Investing Explained. Here's today's question. That is a fantastic question and a very important question to ask. Before I do give you an answer, please allow me to introduce to the audience what the modern portfolio theory is, typically referred to as MPT. The general rule behind MPT is that you want to optimize your return with the least amount of risk, which is a very nice idea. I also have to say that aside from the intention of the idea, the theory and the corresponding model is just so flawed that I would be doing you a great disservice not to tell you already that before I start this argumentation why the model and the theory is flawed, really keep in mind that the best advice I can give you is to completely ignore MPT. MPT is taught in business schools worldwide, and one of the many issues with the model is that it measures risk in terms of volatility, and it doesn't include any thinking in terms of intrinsic value or assessment of the underlying securities. And there is no such thing as intrinsic value in the model, because it assumes that both stocks and bonds are priced correctly at all times and that all asset returns are distributed through a bell-shaped curve around a fictitious assumed rate for the stock market. Now, so if you're thinking, that just made no sense what you said there, Stig, that's completely fine. I couldn't understand it either when my professor spent lecture after lecture in business school explaining why we shouldn't think for ourselves. And so, just to give you an example of how absurd this theory is, when the S&P 500 tanked in March this year and the S&P 500 went from 3,300 to 2,200, academics want you to believe that the price you bought in at wouldn't matter and that it was riskier to buy whenever the market quickly bottomed out of 2,200 than before it was trading at 3,300. And you might as a stock investor be thinking, well, if I can buy the same basket of stocks for 2,200, why would I buy them for 3,300? Wouldn't it just be a better deal just to get them cheaper? And you would be right. And you might also be thinking, what is it really that you learn in all these finance classes? Whatever you're taught that it doesn't make any sense for you to think about what a stock is worth. Because the sum of all people who don't think rationally should make the stock market rational. But that is really a story for another day. I will stop my rant about academia for now. So what is risk? Well, let me borrow Warren Buffett's definition. Buffett defines risk as the permanent loss of capital. That's one. And the second one would be risk of adequate return on capital. Now keep in mind that both of those measures are at the time of decision a qualitative assessment. It's not a fixed calculation. So to sum up, please do forget everything that has to do with the modern portfolio theory or MPT and use Buffett's definition instead if you want to be successful in investing. And to answer the second part of your question, Zach, because you might be thinking, well, if I'm not going to use MPT, then what should I do to diversify? Well, if you want to diversify, you should identify and invest in uncorrelated assets. But really, and this, of course, comes from an investor who tends to be quite concentrated, more than diversification for the sake of diversification, look for investments that have very little risk. The less risk you incur, the less you need to diversify in the first place. I'm curious to hear, what are your thoughts about this, Preston?
So, Stig, the last point that you're talking about, which is the correlation, I think is how Ray Dalio would describe as the holy grail of investing, is finding things that are uncorrelated. So let me just take Zach through a thought experiment. A lot of the times you'll hear professional investors say, oh, you're too concentrated in that sector. I absolutely hate when people say that because it goes against just the logic of digging a little bit deeper. Okay, so let's say we're in the energy sector. Now, the chances are that most of the companies in the energy sector are correlated, but that doesn't mean that they are correlated. So let's say you have company A and you have company B, and the correlation between these two companies is zero. Okay. Those two companies are completely uncorrelated. So if one has, you're valuing these companies, which is a completely separate process, right? You're looking at how correlated they are. You're looking at what you think the value is. And it, let's say that for company A and B, you find both to be of substantial value. Well, if they're completely uncorrelated, your volatility risk becomes reduced. Now, imagine doing that for four companies or five companies or 10 companies. If the proportion of those 10 companies that you own are somewhat equally weighted and your correlation is at zero, you're drastically, drastically reducing that volatility, quote unquote, risk. And I think that I would really challenge people to think in terms of, if you're concerned about volatility and you do buy into academia's definition that risk is equal to volatility, which I don't see it that way. I see the volatility as my opportunity to capture something of value because of the volatility that the lower price offers me whenever it happens. Okay. You just got to make sure that your whole, if you're buying 15 different stocks and they're all correlated at 1.0, right? And there's a lot of volatility in those picks. Well, you better be prepared for a wild ride. But if there's no correlation between the picks, or they sum out to a correlation of zero, and you have a lot of volatility in those and you're weighting them appropriately based on that volatility, you can have all your picks in the same sector if the correlation on it is zero. So I would just challenge that line of thinking. It's usually a good rule of thumb, but you got to dig deeper and you got to actually understand what the correlation is.
That's it. Preston and I will continue explaining investing, so go ahead and hit that subscribe button.